Hey everybody, it's Mike from the Mike Weidner Show, powered by SonicWave Studios and brought to you by official sponsor of the Mike Weidner Show, international warring author Mia Molson's The Missing, available on Amazon and paperback and ebook. We're here with a terrific gentleman who's a celebrated musician born in New Rochelle, Brooklyn, New York area, and members of the 60s group The Turtles, being happy together. Of course, he's happy where he is right now, and he's also served more than five decades.
The music business. He's got a book to talk more about. He began his career listening to classical music and the Beatles, and later honing his skills on piano, drums, guitar, and especially songwriting. Talk more. The Turtles, Dr. John, The Night Tripper, Seals and Crofts, and more. And also, he served as a music director for the Grammys, American Bandstand, showcasing Little Richard and Chuck Berry. And he's got a new book called The Most Famous Musician You Never Heard Of. And who is this musician you never heard of? You're going to find out later on as well, and why he's famous or not so famous. We'll find more about that live, ladies and gentlemen, at Plus Studios in beautiful downtown Los Angeles. The amazing celebrating musician from New York, now living in Los Angeles, member of the Turtles, and he's been in business for five decades, and he's got the best book of all, The Most Famous Musician You Never Heard Of. Ladies and gentlemen, the multi-talented Andy Kahn. Andy, good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Thanks for joining us today.
This is wonderful, Mike. Let's have some fun.
Oh, definitely. Yeah, we're happy together, right? That's right. Yeah.
Absolutely.
There you go. That's right. So you're a celebrating musician born in Brooklyn, New York, and member of the 60s group, The Turtles, being happy together. You served more than five decades as one of the most in-demand collaborators in the music business. And you also began a career listening to classical music and the Beatles, leading up to all kinds of skills. You worked with Jimi Hendrix, Ringo Starr, Frank Zappa, and more. You also served as music director for the Grammys, American Bandstand, showcasing Little Richard, Chuck Berry, and you got the book, The Most Famous Musician You Never Heard Of, all kinds of stories. And before getting all that, Andy, tell us how you first got started.
What should I start with? There's so many stories.
All the way back, machine, way back, Sherman, way back. Like the machine, you've seen Peabody and Sherman from the cartoon days, way back machine.
Okay, so we'll start out when I was 10 years old. And I loved classical music. De Meistersinger, Flying Dutchman Overture, The Rite of Spring, De Meistersinger, you know, all these great classical music pieces. I loved them. And I used to stand up in the living room in front of my parents and all of their friends and be the orchestra leader. And, you know, I knew the timpani.
I can see you do something like that. You know, take like a ruler, take a pencil, and you just go like this, and maybe to like your stuffed animals, pets, everything like that. I'm doing it right now. I can imagine it. So,
yeah, so I loved classical music. And then I borrowed my father's 8mm camera, and I started to make monster movies.
Ooh, scary.
At 14 years old. Frankenstein Meets the Wolfman, The Revenge from Planet 4, all these monster movies. And I did all these special effects inside the camera. It had a still single frame, so I was able to rotate the room in a circle, you know, by taking frame by frame. And then I had a monster hand, and I would make it crawl across the floor on a tripod by taking one frame at a time, like a cartoon.
Oh, wow.
And so I made all these monster movies, and then Kodak came out with the sound projector. So I put sound to all these 8mm movies in 1963.
Oh, wow.
So that was my thing. I was a movie maker, and all those movies are online. If you Google my name and Frankenstein and Frankenstein Meets the Wolfman and Revenge from Planet 4, you can actually watch my 8mm color sound movies from 1963 on YouTube.
Oh my gosh. I'm going to have to get the popcorn and try to be scared on my wits or not too scared. So I'm going to have to go to that. So I'll have to remind myself. So Frankenstein.
Yeah, they're pretty funky since I was 15, 14 years old, making these movies and splicing them. And I was a little Steven Spielberg.
Mm-hmm.
But my sister told me on February 9th, 1964, she said, "Why don't you watch the Ed Sullivan Show tonight? There's a group on called the Beatles."
Mm-hmm.
And guess what happened? The same thing that happened to millions of musicians. They wanted to be a Beatle. They were so impressed with these four guys with the Beatle haircuts, with the suits, with the Beatle boots, and they wrote and sang their own songs, and they were amazing. So I wanted to be a Beatle. So that got me started as a musician. And I loved the Dave Clark Five.
Oh, one of my Mike favorites. Smith.
And so I bought a Farfisa organ. You know what a Farfisa organ is? A cheap little cheesy organ, but it had left-hand bass. So I played the bass Ooh. With my left hand. And I ran it through a Hammond Leslie speaker. So it was very cool. And I had a band called The Individuals. And later, it was released by Moxie Records. All these demos from 1965 were released as Johnny Farfisa.
Huh,
because they had a Farfisa organ. And then Munster Records in Spain licensed these Johnny Farfisa songs and released it. And two other record companies licensed this one song called She's Gone Away. It's an instrumental. And it was like a garage band hit. Everybody loved that. And I actually went on YouTube and I found a band in Belgium on the stage performing the song I wrote in 1965, exactly like the record.
Oh my gosh.
That was an honor. Johnny Farfisa.
Johnny Farfisa. I'm going to have to remember that name. Johnny Farfisa. So that's a name everybody's going to remember. Everybody's watching. Yes.
If you Google it, you'll find a whole bunch of Johnny Farfisa music online.
Okay. All right. Well, certainly check that out. Beatles and everything else. We're having a little bit of technical difficulty. Get some bugs in there. But who are some of our other... Who are some of my other favorite artists, songwriters, and everything else?
Okay, I missed the question because your mic cut out.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry. So who are some of my other favorite artists, songwriters, and musicians growing up?
Oh, well, the British Invasion, the Kinks, the Zombies, the Dave Clark Five, the Bo Brummels, the Beatles. I loved Cream. And, I love the Love and Spoonful and Jimi Hendrix and Led Zeppelin and all that stuff from the 60s. That's my love. That's what I love a lot.
Oh, my gosh. And that had to be. And you also worked with some of the legends as well, too. Jimi Hendrix, Ringo Starr, Frank Zappa. You being on Turtles. We'll talk more about that, along with the book, The Most Famous Musician You Never Heard Of, which is Andy Kahn, but it will be after this. But first, listen to The Mike Wagner Show at themikewagnershow.com. Powered by Sonic Web Studios. Visit online at sonicwebstudios.com for all your needs. Looking at a professional website without breaking your budget? Sonic Web Studios is the answer. Sonic Web Studios offers fast, affordable custom web designs that blow the competition away. Call today, 1-800-303-3960. That's 1-800-303-3960. Or email to support at sonicwebstudios.com. Mention The Mike Wagner Show, get 20% off your first project. Sonic Web Studios, take your image to the next level. Also, time to give official shout-out to our official sponsor, The Mike Wagner Show, international warring author Mia Molson-Zia. If you love fast-paced mysteries, you'll love Missing by Mia Molson-Zia, available on Amazon, a paperback and ebook. Missing is fast-paced and intriguing with an unforgettable twist. It takes place in four countries, two strangers, one target, where truth is illusion and those you love be the first go missing. It's available on Amazon, a paperback and ebook. Missing by Mia Molson-Zia has garnered great reviews. In Evil Love and Doors by Howard celebrities, including Joanna Cassidy, Forge Riley, and Manalis. So grab your copy today for Girls Missing by Mia Molson-Zia, available on Amazon. Also, check out The Mike Wagner Show at themikewagnershow.com on our 40 podcast platforms. Heard in 100 countries, including Facebook, SoundCloud, Spreaker, Spotify, iHeartRadio, also Anchor FM, as well as Audible and also Pandora And also Podbean, Odyssey, BitChute, Rumble, YouTube. Make sure you subscribe. Also follow us on social media, Instagram, LinkedIn, Twitter, TikTok, Facebook, and more. Take us with you on any mobile device. And for great gift ideas, go to Amazon.com. Check out the Mike Weiner Show podcast. Got T-shirts, pop sockets, throw pillows, tote bags, hoodies. Makes great gifts 24/7. Go to Amazon.com. Be sure to check out the Mike Weiner Show podcast. And for more great gift ideas, go to Amazon.com/meandbostonzia for great books like Missing, Once and Wrinkles. Also T-shirts, pop sockets, hoodies, phone cases, and more. Amazon.com/meandbostonzia. Check it out today and support the Mike Weiner Show on Anchor FM, PayPal, and the MikeWeinerShow.com. We're here with the amazing celebrity musician from Brooklyn, New York, now Los Angeles, Andy Kahn here on the Mike Weiner Show. And I know you're eager to talk about the book, The Most Famous Musician Never Heard Of. And I saw you're doing this and while we're doing a break and everything. And I think I'm taking some tips from you and everything else. Yeah, I mean, you worked with some amazing people as well, too. Worked with Jimi Hendrix, Ringo Starr, Frank Zappa, The Turtles, Dr. John, Seals and Crofts. And of course, you know, I guess we'll just start with The Turtles, basically. You're basically well known for that, as well as We're Happy Together.
Yeah, I met The Turtles when I was with Jimmy Carl Black. He was the original drummer from Frank Zappa's Mothers of Invention. And we had a band called Geronimo Black. And Frank Zappa said, I'm doing a movie called 200 Motels, and I want you to be in it. So he invited Jimmy to come down to rehearsal for the movie. And Flo and Eddie, the Turtles, were in the movie as well. They did a song called Lonesome Cowboy Bert with Jimmy. They sang the background vocals, and Jimmy sang lead.
How do you like that?
And so that's how I met the Turtles. And I had also been working with Little Richard doing the soundtrack for a movie called Let the Good Times Roll that Richard Nathan put out. And I was doing some organ overdubs at Cherokee Studios. And Flo and Eddie said, we need a keyboard player to go on the road. Would you be interested? And in 1973, I joined the Turtles. And I've been with the Turtles 40 years.
Wow.
1973 to 2013.
Oh, my gosh. That's amazing. Wow. I had a lot of fun on the road as well, too. You talked about Jimi Hendrix, you know, working with him on the soundtrack, the organ, and everything else. And, of course, you know, Jimi Hendrix. What was it like?
Well, my mom was good friends with a record company executive named Irwin Garr. He was with ABC Dunhill producing the Mamas and the Papas. And he started his own record label called Pulsar Records. And he hired me as a gopher for 35 bucks a week to go, you know, take pictures of the musicians at the recording sessions and pick them up and drive them to the studio and all that. So there were two artists on his label, Dr. John the Night Tripper, Mac Rabinac, and Graham Bond, who was a blues artist from England with Ginger Baker and Jack Bruce.
Oh my gosh.
In the Graham Bond organization. And then Graham called me up one day and he said, we got a recording session. You want to come and bring your harpsichord and we'll jam at this recording session. So I arrive at the studio and Mitch Mitchell was setting up his drums. And Lowell George of Little Feet was playing the flute. And Jack Cassidy of the Jefferson Airplane was on the bass. And Graham Bond was on the Hammond B3. And I was setting up my harpsichord. And I felt something strange. And I turned around and in walks Jimi Hendrix with two blonde chicks. One holding his amplifier and the other one holding his guitar.
Wow.
And they came in the room and Jimmy sat down right next to me. I could touch him. He was right there. And we played the blues in A for about 2 hours.
Oh, my gosh.
And, it was psychedelic. It was really amazing. Quite a goosebumps. I had goosebumps for the whole recording session with all these celebrity musicians, and I was just 20-year-old. So it was quite amazing.
Oh my gosh, that had to be amazing. I wish that Jimi Hendrix was with me right now taking in the experience. That had to be like that. So oh my gosh. And of course, and I think you had somebody chase around in a hotel. And you know, I'd care more about that. We're talking about the book, The Most Famous Musician You Never Heard of on the Mike Wagner Show. Somebody had to chase you around the hotel. Who was that?
We did a concert with Felix Cavalieri of the Rascals and Chubby Checker and the Turtles. And it was in Las Vegas at Bally's. And we did the show. Chubby Checker was wonderful. Felix, the show went wonderful. It was a lot of fun. And I got to hang out with Chubby. And then the next morning in the lobby of the hotel, everybody's checking out. Mm-hmm. And I'm just standing at the counter checking out, and I look down the hallway, and way down the hallway is Chubby Checker with his mom, and his mom was in a wheelchair.
Mm.
So Chubby Checker wheeled his mom down the hallway, but he went really fast.
Really?
And he aimed his mom at me. So he rolling the wheelchair down the hallway as fast as he could, aiming, trying to run me over. And at the last minute, I jump out of the way, and Chubby Checker and his mom were laughing as they passed me by. So I almost got ran over by Chubby Checker and his mom.
Oh, my gosh. I suppose he's trying to put that in his memoir or try and make a story out of it.
Yeah, I have a lot of really funny, funny stories in my book. It's a long book. It's got a lot of pages, a lot of stories, a lot of pictures. It's really a lot of fun.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah. And, of course, you know, one of them, Ringo Starr, we were talking about the Beatles early as well, too. And and Ringo chose you to work for him. And what happened after that?
Well, I met Ringo because I was friends with Harry Nilsson.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're familiar with Harry Nilsson, he won the Grammy for Everybody's Talking About Me. They don't
that was from what? Midnight Cowboy, was that right? Or
yeah, Midnight Cowboy, and he also won a Grammy. I can't live living.
Oh, can't live without you. That's the one. I remember.
Right.
That.
So he won two Grammys, and he was the Beatles' favorite singer-songwriter. So one day he got Ringo Starr to come over to my living room, and we recorded some children's stories.
Oh, really?
That Van Dyke Parks and Harry Nilsson and myself were going to put the music behind Ringo's voice. So that's when I met Ringo. But prior to that, Kinky Friedman did an album called Lasso from El Paso. And there's a song on there called Men's Room LA.
Mm-hmm.
And I was asked to play the Hammond B3 organ and do background vocals behind Ringo Starr doing a cameo, playing the part of Jesus, who's in the bathroom, and there's no toilet paper in the bathroom. So Jesus is sitting on the toilet, and they can't find any toilet paper. And that's Ringo Starr's cameo in this song called Men's Room LA.
Oh, so Jesus.
That was before I met Ringo, but after I met Ringo, we went over to Ringo's house. Harry Nilsson and me and Ringo were sitting in his living room, and he had a guitar sitting there by the couch. And I said, "Do you mind if I play your guitar?" He says, "No, go right ahead." So I pick up the guitar and I start strumming. Ding, ding, ka-jang, ding, 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 ka-jang. And then Harry Nilsson started singing, "Listen for your footsteps coming up the drive." And then Ringo joins in. So here I am in Ringo Starr's living room playing Don't Pass Me By with Harry Nilsson and Ringo Starr.
Oh,
and
my
Ringo
gosh.
Ringo was the sweetest, most down-to-earth, great storyteller. He told the story about Mal Evans, who was the roadie for the Beatles, and he was on an airplane with Paul McCartney.
Wow.
And they're sitting there eating their food on the airplane, and there was a salt and pepper thing on the tray. So Paul McCartney said to Mal Evans, this is what Ringo told me. Paul McCartney said, I want to do a different album where it's not the Beatles. It's a fictitious name of some other band. And it's like a story. You know, the whole album is like a story. And so Mal Evans, he picks up the pepper and he goes, why don't you call it Sergeant Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band?
Interesting. So on a plain salt and pepper shaker? Oh my gosh, I didn't know that.
And it was Mal Evans who thought of the name Sergeant Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band.
Ah, that's interesting. Based on a salt and pepper shaker, but you know, maybe the Lonely Hearts is like, are the salt and peppers really that lonely or something, or what?
It was really funny. That's what Ringo Starr said the story was. That's how Paul started Sergeant Pepper. Paul was the leader of the band, he and John, but Paul inspired everybody to play, rehearse, record. Paul was the guy who called everybody up and said, let's go to the studio. Come on, let's go. So that was Paul. He was the instigator.
Now I know why John Lennon gets pissed off at him at times, and George kind of likes to just stay quiet in the whole thing, and Ringo, he's Ringo, but then he'll say, like, I'll be nice about it, but then I'll get kind of nasty about it at times, too.
Well, they went through a lot, but they were the most famous band ever.
Mm-hmm. And of course, you know, you also worked with Ringo as well, too. And according to your book, he threatened to sue you?
Well, it wasn't a suit. He recorded in my living room.
Mm-hmm.
And I advertised in a music magazine that Ringo Starr was in my living room. I had a picture of me and Ringo.
Uh-huh.
It's actually this picture right here.
Oh, wow. Okay. All right. Ringo, yeah,
there's me and Ringo
okay.
Right there.
Cool. All right.
So I advertised my studio. It was called The Demo Doctor, and I made demos for people. So Ringo's attorney sent me a letter saying, no, you can't use Ringo to advertise your studio.
Why?
So no more pictures of Ringo advertising your studio. So that's what happened. It's not a lawsuit, but it was, him to saying, you can use Ringo Starr to advertise your studio.
So that's really
what happened.
Really? Why is that? That's a head scratcher.
Well, when you're a Beatle, everybody takes advantage of you.
Got it.
They try to steal your music. They try to steal your products. So Ringo and Paul don't want to sign any more autographs. They're fed up with it. You know, no more autographs.
Right. Yeah. And that makes perfect sense as well, too, that you also have more of your book. And of course, you're doing a little song and dance with your book and everything, doing a break. And notice Linda Ronstadt was in there, too. And you have a pretty good adventure with her.
Yeah. Harry Nilsson and Linda Ronstadt and I were at a recording studio. Jimmy Webb was recording an album, and Linda Ronstadt was co-producing the album. And then Harry kidnapped Jimmy and he said, come on, let's go over to Andy's house. And I want to do the song that you wrote. And Jimmy wrote this song called What Does a Woman See in a Man?
Mm.
So we got Jimmy to play it on my studio keyboard. And then we took Jimmy back to the studio with Linda Ronstadt. And then Harry came back to my house and sang the vocals. And it's on the very last Harry Nilsson album. And then later on, Jimmy played at the Hollywood Roosevelt Hotel. So Linda Ronstadt and Harry Nilsson and I went to go see him play. And Linda was, I tell you, she's just the sweetest, most talented person you're ever going to meet.
Oh, yeah. And of course, you know, being that state as well, too. Of course, you know, she had to retire from the business and, you know, sell her collection and everything. I mean, just an amazing individual as well, too. And now I'm trying to think some of the other ones you touched upon. And I'm thinking about who was it? Oh, Billy Bob Thornton. There's another one that just kind of pops up in a book as well, too. And I guess the word is that he tried to scare you half to death.
Absolutely. Howard Kalin and I decided to do an album called Dust Bunnies, and it was 10 songs that Howard loved that he always wanted to record. Howard is the lead singer of the Turtles. So we went into my living room and cut these demos for 10 songs. And then Howard played the demos to a friend of Billy Bob Thornton's, I can't remember his name right now, but Billy Bob Thornton said, "Hey, why don't you finish the album in my studio?" He had a studio in his home on Roxbury Drive in Beverly Hills. Now, the thing with Billy Bob Thornton is he bought his house from
Really?
Slash from Guns N' Roses, who built the studio in the basement. And
Wow.
the original owner of the house was Cecil B. DeMille. And
Really?
in
Cecil
the
B. DeMille, The Ten Commandments. Oh my gosh, what a connection.
he was the original owner, and during Prohibition, he would have secret parties, you know, where they'd serve alcohol illegally. And he had a tunnel that ran from a phony storefront on La Cienega Boulevard underground to his basement in Beverly Hills. And he would get all these celebrities to come over, all the movie stars, and he would have parties with liquor in his basement. And so he sold the house to Roger Corman, and Roger sold the house to Dudley Moore. No, Roman Polanski, and Roman Polanski sold the house to Slash, and Slash built the studio in the basement, and then Billy Bob Thornton bought the house from Slash.
Oh
So
my goodness.
I'm sitting in the studio with Billy Bob Thornton and it was 4 o'clock in the morning, and I'm saying to him, "Hey, could you do Carl for me?" You see, Billy Bob Thornton wrote this movie called Sling Blade, and the lead character was Carl. And it was a really very crazy guy, you know. So at 4 o'clock in the morning, I asked Billy to play the part of Carl for me. So he got in the chair, he scruffled up his shoulders, he turned around, he goes, "Ah, I got a turtle here." He scared the hell out of me. It was
I
really
got a
amazing.
turtle.
And yeah, he never slept. He always worked, always, always, always working. A genius. I met him when he was doing Bad Santa, and
Oh my
we would
gosh.
watch all the outtakes, you know, all the dailies, and it was funny, funny stuff. Billy Bob Thornton is an incredible actor, great actor.
Oh my gosh, that is something as well too. You seem to have a lot of influence, you know, working way in the Beatles, also working way into the Turtles and more. And of course, you know, something that stands out, Frank Zappa and the Mothers of Invention. How'd you first get involved?
Well, Jimmy Carl Black, that band I had in 1968 called Geronimo Black. I was friends with all of the Mothers: Don Preston, Elliot Ingberg, Motorhead Sherwood, Bunk Gardner, Buzz Gardner, Artie Tripp, Ruth Underwood, Ian Underwood. I knew all of the Mothers. And so I met Frank Zappa, and he wrote a song for Jimmy Carl Black called "Falling in Love Is a Stupid Habit." And
What?
if you Google it, you can actually hear it on YouTube. Just Google Frank Zappa, falling in love is a stupid habit. And it's the demo that we cut in Frank Zappa's living room with Jimmy Carl Black and Motorhead Sherwood, and I went to Frank's house and we cut this demo that Jimmy Carl Black was supposed to record.
Oh my
gosh. But that never happened. But Frank Zappa would come up on stage with the Turtles because Flo and Eddie recorded three or four albums with Frank Zappa. And of course, Jimmy Carl Black and I had the band called Geronimo Black. So in both of those bands, Frank Zappa would come up on stage and do his, you know, leading of the band and doing all the crazy Frank Zappa stuff. So he was a genius, as we all know.
Right.
And, he didn't want any of his musicians to smoke pot. Everybody had to be straight. But Flo and Eddie always smoked pot, and he let them get away with it.
Mm-hmm. And of course, there are the Turtles as well, too. I was thinking about Frank Zappa. I saw something on YouTube. He was on Johnny Carson, and he got to play a song on a bicycle. What a genius.
Yeah, that was Steve Allen.
How was that?
It was the Steve Allen show way back in the 50s. And Frank Zappa was a very young, ugly-looking guy. And he brought a bicycle on the stage, and he played music on the spokes and on the wheel and on the handlebars. And that was like Edgar Varese. Have you ever heard of Edgar Varese?
No, I haven't, but I'd love to learn more about him.
Well, Frank Zappa really liked Edgar Varese's music, and it was very odd sounds of, you know, like a bottle or a tube or a wooden box or, you know, wind chimes.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what
Frank Zappa really,
he loved that avant-garde crazy music stuff.
Oh my goodness. Oh wow. I have a lot of these bands I'm just going over, but here's one more before we get to your success here. Seals and Crofts, one of my other favorites. What's it like?
Yes, a good friend of mine named Scooby. He was the musicians union representative in Hollywood, and he would get me all these gigs. And one of the gigs he got me was with Jimmy Seals and Dash Crofts, and it was a top 40 band, and Jimmy Seals played the saxophone.
Wow.
And Dash Crofts played the drums, and I was on the organ, and we had a guitar and bass, and we did all the top 40 stuff like Rock the Boat Baby and all that top 40. And so during the break, Jimmy and Dash would get up on stage as a duo and with the mandolin and the guitar, and they would do the Seals and Crofts material. So we're sitting at the table during a break, and Jimmy Seals says, you know, we're trying to think of a name for our duo, you know, and they belong to the Baha'i religion. And the leader of the Baha'i religion's name was Baha'u'llah. So Jimmy says to me, why don't we call the duo Baha'u'llah? And I laughed and I went, Baha'u'llah, what? You know, Abbott and Costello, Laurel and Hardy, you know, Tom and Jerry. How about Seals and Crofts?
How do you like that?
And Jimmy and Dash looked at each other and went, okay. So I was the guy who thought of the name Seals and Crofts.
How do you like that? I mean, you're one hell of an entrepreneur and all that. So it's like, how'd you get right that? And how'd you become independent, production, everything? And of course, continue to talk about the book, Most Famous Musician Never Heard Of, Entrepreneur and More. We'll find out in just 1 minute. You listen to The Mike Wagner Show at themikewagnershow.com, powered by Sonic Web Studios, and brought to you by official sponsor of The Mike Wagner Show, international warring author Mia Muslin's The Missing. We'll be back with the amazing multi-talented Andy Kahn after this timeout. We're back to the amazing multi-talented Andy Kahn here on the Mike Wagner Show, 50 years in business. And yes, he's the most famous musician you never heard of. And not only that, he is also the most famous entrepreneur you may never heard of, or launching his own record label you never heard of, or even production company.
There was some really very, very wonderful moments. One morning I got a phone call from Bumps Blackwell. Now, Bumps Blackwell was the co-writer of Tutti Frutti, Good Golly Miss Molly, Rip It Up, you know, all the Little Richard songs. Bumps Blackwell co-wrote those songs with Little Richard.
Mm-hmm.
And so Little Richard was going on the road to do a tour, and he needed a drummer and an organ player. So Bumps Blackwell called up our drummer, Craig Cramp. And then Craig called me up and he said, Little Richard wants an organ player and we're leaving tomorrow morning from the airport to go to Philadelphia.
Oh my
gosh.
So
with no rehearsal, we went to the gig, a sold out huge, you know, venue, 70,000 people. And we played all the Little Richard hits. And he loved the band, so he kept the band. And we went to Australia, and we did the Richard Nader Rock and Roll Revival Tour. And then the Grammy Awards wanted Little Richard and Chuck Berry to perform at the Grammys to give out the award for the best song of the year.
Oh, wow.
So they hired me as the music director for the Grammys. So here I am in a little tiny room with an upright piano with Little Richard and Chuck Berry with his guitar, and we rehearsed their hit songs for the show. It was just the three of us.
Oh, my gosh.
And it was like the most exciting moment in my life because the Beatles idolized Little Richard and Chuck Berry. Paul McCartney idolized Little Richard, and John Lennon idolized Chuck Berry. So here I was with the Beatles' idols rehearsing their hit records. Mm-hmm. So that was totally amazing. And that is also on YouTube. If you Google Little Richard, Chuck Berry, the Grammys, you'll see my funny face in the middle of the stage playing the grand piano.
Oh my gosh, I'm taking this all in right now as we speak here. So yeah, all that. So, and of course, I was going to get to one more thing. This may seem a little silly. It's like, you know, John worshiped Little Richard, Paul worshiped, what was it, Chuck Berry, or it's like all the way around. What about George Harrison, Ringo Starr? Who do they look up to?
Oh, well, you know, George Harrison, he loved the sitar, and he loved all that, you know, Ravi Shankar and all that. And Ringo really loved the old blues, the old country western blues.
Hmm.
He really liked all that. His first album, Sentimental Journey, was really the kind of material that Ringo loved to sing, you know? And, you know, when he did Act Naturally, they're going to put me in the movies.
Oh, yeah. Letter done by Buck Owens. That's one of my favorites.
Yeah, definitely. And, you know, George idolized the same people. He idolized the Everly Brothers and Carl Perkins and all these great, in England, they called it skiffle.
Mm-hmm.
But over here, it was called rockabilly.
Uh-huh.
Gene Vincent had a lot of early rockabilly stuff. So that's all the early late 50s, 58, 56, 57, wow. All the great rockabilly. And the British called it skiffle. So
skiffle.
It's the same stuff, the same rock stuff. But they all loved that. They all loved that stuff.
Oh my gosh, you know something? I'm learning a lot from you today, Andy. I got to say that, and learning a lot. And we also got the book, The Most Famous Musician You Never Heard Of, here on the Mike Wagner Show. And what are some of the things we haven't covered yet? And maybe a bit more we haven't talked about. And what do you want to get the readers, have the readers get out of the book?
Well, yeah, if you Google The Most Famous Musician You've Never Heard Of, You'll this will pop up, and it'll have a sample chapter on a website with Harry Nilsson, Ringo Starr, Joe Walsh, and Timothy Leary.
How do you like that? Timothy Leary. Boy, I haven't heard that name in a while.
Harry Nilsson would come over to my living room and we'd record another song, and then he'd surprise me by taking me over different people's homes. So we went to Timothy Leary's house, we went to Joe Walsh's house, we went to Bill Martin, who wrote the movie Harry and the Hendersons. He also wrote a hit song for Linda Ronstadt. And so Harry would take me to all these celebrities' homes. It was really quite amazing meeting Timothy Leary. When we came to his front door, Timothy Leary took Harry by the cheek and kissed him on the mouth. And then he said, and then he looked at me and he said, "Who's that?" And Harry said, "Oh, that's my friend Andy." So Timothy Leary grabbed me by the cheeks and kissed me on the mouth. Then he invited us into his house, and there was a huge 14-foot Gumby in the hallway.
Really?
And
Oh my
then
goodness.
you make a right-hand turn and you go into the kitchen, and there's a gigantic rainbow table in the kitchen. And then we went into the living room, and he's got all these teenage girls, running around the house, and he was showing a movie that he made called Love. And then he had a bass fiddle, like a big stand-up bass, and he laid it down on the rug and he turned it upside down so the wood was sticking up. And then he started to play a rhythm on the wood. And then Harry Nilsson picked up a spoon and started to make noise with the spoon. And then I picked up something else, a bottle, and we all made music on the floor with Timothy Leary. So this is the kind of stuff that is really amazing.
Oh my gosh. And there had to be more on the book as well, too. Where can we find the book, The Most Famous Musician You Never Heard Of?
It's on Amazon, Amazon.com. And you just Google "The Most Famous Musician You Never Heard Of," and it'll pop right up. And like I said, there's a sample chapter in this art, in the website with Harry Nilsson, Ringo Starr, Joe Walsh, and Timothy Leary. But another old celebrity that I was very fortunate to work with, because Flo and Eddie were doing cartoons.
Oh my gosh.
They did Strawberry Shortcake, G.I. Joe, the
Wow.
Care Bears. I did all the music for all these cartoons on a Casio keyboard, a real little baby Casio.
Oh
And
yeah, I
then,
remember those. We have those in the household, and my boys get a hold of it and they fight over it sometimes. I think about that Casio keyboard. They fight over that thing.
so it was a lot of fun making those Strawberry Shortcake cartoon soundtracks. And then we got offered a job to do a movie, a cartoon called Peter and the Magic Egg. And it was the story of Easter with Peter Paws. And the lead character, the rabbit, was played by Ray Bolger.
How do you
You
like
know who
that?
Ray Bolger is?
Yes, Wizard of Oz.
He was the straw man in The Wizard of Oz. So he was like 78 years old.
Wow.
And we went over to his house, and I sat down next to him at the piano to rehearse this cartoon music that he was going to sing. And I was completely blown away because The Wizard of Oz was my favorite movie. And here I am sitting next to the scarecrow. So he's sitting next to me, and he looks at me and he goes, "Do you want to know what it was like to be in the Wizard of Oz?" And I'm going, "Oh my God." So he would tell all these stories, how the Munchkins were treated horrible.
Really?
Everybody in the crew and the actors really didn't like little people. They treated them like really bad. So one day they decided to get back at Dorothy, because Dorothy really didn't like the Munchkins either. So they got a paper bag and they put dog poop in the paper bag. Then they went to Dorothy's trailer, her dressing room trailer, and they put the paper bag, they lit it on fire. And they put it on the floor, and then they knocked at her dressing room door and they ran away. So Dorothy comes to the door, opens up the door, and sees this fire. So she steps on it, you know, so it's got the poop in the fire. Anyway, this is what Ray Bolger told me about The Wizard of Oz.
Oh, you know, my gosh.
And they shot the entire movie on the Gower Studios soundstage on Melrose in Hollywood. It was all live. There was no overdub. The orchestra was live. The actors were live. Everything was live.
Wow.
So it was totally amazing. Totally amazing.
Oh my gosh. I'm about to see that movie again and remind Dorothy. Yeah, don't do that in Kansas, please, okay? Oh my gosh, that's so wild. We're here with the amazing Andy Kahn of the Most Famous Musician Never Heard Of here on the Mike Wagner Show. Just a few more things, Andy. Love to have you back and love sharing stories and everything. What else can we expect from you in 2024 and beyond?
What is what?
What else can we expect from you in 2024 and beyond?
Oh, well, I'm going to do a book tour with a live band and play the music from the book.
Okay.
And do a book signing and question and answer. I did that at the Grammy Museum in Los Angeles.
Oh, nice.
I had a band from Canada called the Dreamboats, mm-hmm. and they performed the music from the book.
Wow.
Including an original song I wrote called Late Bloomer.
Nice.
So that was very successful. So that's my plan, is to get a world tour promoting the book and playing music from the book, you know, Little Richard, Chuck Berry, Seals and Croft, The Turtles, Frank Zappa, Harry Nilsson, Dr. John, you know, Jimmy Webb, all these songs will be playing on stage.
Oh my gosh. I'm certainly looking forward to it. Love to have you back on, you know, tour and everything like that. And who do you consider biggest influence in your career?
Little Richard. Little Richard was the most amazing entertainer ever, 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 ever.
Mm-hmm.
Amazing. And he was a sweetheart. He was always a giving, happy, positive guy. Nothing negative. Always positive. A genius.
Mm.
And that's why the Beatles, that's why Paul McCartney loved him so much.
A genius indeed. That's right. We got to remember that. And what's the best advice you can give to anybody at this point?
Do your own thing and don't let anybody tell you what to do. Just stick to your guns and do what you believe. And that's the key right there, because that's a projection of yourself. And if people start telling you what to do, do what you want to do. That's my advice.
That's been the best I've heard in years. I got to say that. That is the best. We're the amazing, multi-talented Andy Kahn of the book, The Most Famous Musician Never Heard Of here on the Mike Wagner Show. I guess he's now famous here, as you can tell. And Andy, a very big thank you for your time. Very, very fantastic. Looking forward to having you soon. Keep us up to date. Keep in touch. And definitely live have you back. Once again, I forgot to ask you, what's your website? How do people contact you? And once again, where can you purchase your book?
Yes, if you go to Amazon.com and you Google The Most Famous Musician You Never Heard Of, the book will pop up. And you could just go to Google and type in The Most Famous Musician You've Never Heard Of. And it'll pop right up. And it's really a wonderful book. It's got pictures and stories of a lot of celebrities. It's a very, very fun book. It's a heavy 2-pound coffee table book. It's a lot of fun.
and certainly worth it as well, too. We're all looking forward to it. Once again, Andy, very big thank you for your time. You've been absolutely fantastic. Looking forward to having you soon. Keep us up to date. Keep in touch. We love having you back. We wish all the best. And Andy, you definitely have a great future, have you?
All right. I'm looking forward to seeing the show on the social media.